Good to see all of you. We trust you had a good 4th of July and didn't get burned too much from all the fireworks. But what a joy. What a time in Lindenville. I never saw such population before in Lindenville's the 4th of July. Streets are teeming with people. And boy, if you weren't a people person, it was kind of scary. But we're glad you're here. The Lord is with us. And he isn't just up there. He's down here right now in our presence. And he's here to teach. He's here to bless. He's here to convict. And sometimes we need correction. Sometimes we need comfort. Lord knows how many times we need encouragement along the way to stay focused, keep moving forward in faith and trust. And as we come to the communion table today, we are indeed in a precious way reminded of him who loved us and loves us and gave himself up for us. And so he gave himself up for you. And we're going to explore that today. I'd like to read just a few verses from Psalm 34 to open the worship. David wrote, "I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make its boast in the Lord, and the humble shall hear of it and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together." I can't think of any better way to open a service than those very words today. Let's exalt him. Let's magnify him together as one body in Christ. For our morning prayer, being communion, we'll recite the Lord's Prayer together using the word debts, okay? So let's give it a try. Let's bow our heads and pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the glory and the glory forever. Amen.
All right, let's stand and sing this morning, One True God.
Thank you.
like to mention that we will be having a reception for Joe. We're glad to have you here. Where is he? Oh, there he is. All right. I knew he wasn't raptured yet. We'll have Joe come in a little while and read scripture. We're so glad to have, obviously, the Smiths with us. Tomorrow is liftoff for Cody, Wyoming. So pray for Joe and Julianne and the family. It's kind of joy and sadness all in one lump sum as a local church. What a thrill, what a joy. And yet we rejoice with them that they have been sensitive to God's leading and are being obedient to his call. And may many be saved out in Cody, Wyoming, because of your presence, Joe. We praise the Lord for that. I want to mention that the reception will be during Sunday school, so there will be no regular Sunday school hour today upstairs. Wednesday's prayer and share time as well. So bear that in mind. Weather permitting, we'll try to meet out in a pavilion. All right? So this makes a nice outdoor setting for prayer and share. Yes, go right ahead, Genoa.
I didn't get it to Dee Dee, but two Wednesdays, I think it's the 17th. We'll do 6 to 7 before prayer and share time, family night meeting. I will get sign up ready so that we can get it rolling, because next year September will come.
Lord willing, Crick don't rise. Thank you, Genoa. Okay, is there anything else? Yes, Janetta. Okay, mission board meeting Tuesday. Are they trustees scheduled? Do you know Kent? Okay, all righty. Yes, I see that hand, Joyce. Oh, praise the Lord. Thank you, Joyce. We're glad to have Joyce's mother, Trudy, with us. And she is 104. Okay. We could save the speech for next time, but welcome, Trudy. We're also glad to have our daughter Anna with us, and she's from the country of Panama. And trust me, her Espanol is pretty good. After all these years in Panama, we're joyed to have her here. She will be attending next week a teacher's conference in Syracuse, so be in prayer for Anna. And flying back to Panama the 20th, I believe, of July. So we're thrilled to have her home. Amen. Okay. At this time, I believe Joe will come and read the scripture for us.
All right, please meet me at Galatians chapter 6, verses 11 through 18. If you'd like to stand, please do so. Just making sure that's the right one. All right. Galatians chapter 6, verse 11 says, "You see how large a letter I've written unto you with my own hand. As many as desire to make a fair show in the flesh, they constrain you to be circumcised, only lest they should suffer persecution for the cross of Christ. For neither they themselves who are circumcised keep the law, but desire to have you circumcised, that they may glory in your flesh. But God forbid that I should glory, save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me, and I unto the world. For in Christ Jesus neither circumcision avails anything, nor uncircumcision, but a new creature. And as many as walk according to this rule, peace be on them, and mercy, and upon the Israel of God. From henceforth let no man trouble me, for I bear in my body the marks of the Lord Jesus. Brethren, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. Amen.
Hebrews 9:22 says, without the shedding of blood is no remission. And you know, dear folks, I know our lives would be totally different if we had been at Golgotha when they took the bloody body of the Lord Jesus Christ, the crown of thorns and the blood oozing out of his head, the scourging from the back, the nails in the hands and the feet. Without the shedding of blood is no forgiveness, written in red. In letters of crimson, love on a hillside so long, long ago. For you and for me, Jesus died, and love's greatest story was told. I love you, I love you. That's what Calvary said. I love you, I love you. I love you.
I'm glad the Lord feels that way. He says, I love you, period. Not because of or if you do this or do that. It's I love you, period. And so unconditional. Hallelujah. Thank you, Wally. It's beautiful. If the ushers could please make their way to the front, we'll wait upon you for today's offering. And again, we're deeply grateful for the giving spirit here. We're glad to see Martha Matthews last Sunday. And we had a nice a little love offering to send her on her way to aid her sister and to get her back to Ireland. So do pray for the Matthews family for sure. Father, we are so glad that we can reflect your own heart in our giving spirit. Thank you, Lord. It is more blessed to give than to receive. Though it is a blessing to receive, it's a far greater blessing to give. And we can never outgive you because you gave your very best in your only Son, Jesus. And we're thankful that indeed our names are written and read in the Lamb's Book of Life. Thank you so much for these blessings and for what we've been receiving in worship today. We give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you. Michael Froman's going to come at this time and give his personal testimony.
Amen.
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 We can bring Lou Ann if you want.
God bless you, brother. I wouldn't be. You'll survive.
Since Brad asked me, the first time he asked me to do this, I had just so many things spinning in my head. So many stories, so many parts of my journey. And I had to pick out which part to share with you. And I don't want to take all your time. And believe me, we all have a story, and through the journey, there was plenty of tears, laughter, joy. And in the past couple years, I've had to deal with, you know, loss of loved ones. But I've said it before, and I say it again, that this church is just a great family and comfort to help me through and help all of us through the ones we lose. It's, and I can't thank you enough. I just love this church and love everyone here. It's filled with so much encouragement and love and inspiration. That's the word I was looking for. I'm inspired by the gentleman that just sang, and I'll share with you that this isn't my first time up here. I did attempt to sing a song. It was, I don't know if anybody is still here that remembers it, but it was a while ago, and I want to tell Lori that I've been working on my vocal talents to, and one of these Sundays it's going to be, I'm just telling you now, I'm preparing something, and then but there was like I said, there's tons of stories, but the one that really helped me realize that God was by my side was a period in my life where alcohol was involved. And I know it affects everybody in a different way, but I made a choice at the time to do it or drink too much. I made the choice. I made bad choices, and once I drank too much, I didn't like the person I was, and it got me in trouble. It got me in trouble where I lost my license, had to lean on. Well, lean on God, especially, but I had a good partner that got me through it. Finally, the time that I realized that alcohol was a problem was when I stood up at a AA meeting and just said, introduce myself, I'm Bernie Froman, and I'm an alcoholic. And that really opened my eyes right there, and it just brought me to a point where I didn't want to stay on that same path. I needed to realize that God was there helping me along the way, and realize I needed to go back to Him and lean on Him all the more. And the beginning, I mean, there was a seed planted early on when I was younger. I was born on a Six Nations reservation in Canada. And I had a chance to, I wasn't born into a Christian family, but I had a chance to go to a church, a small little church on the reservation. And I, the old hymns really got me then, and it still sticks with me now. And I just love the old hymns, and we sing it, and that's why, you know, you're an inspiration. Dick is my inspiration, because I want to be like him when I grow up, and I heard the first song that we all knew at a young age is that Jesus loved me. This I know because the Bible says so. And it started right from there, and through my whole walk, you know, every now and then a song will pop up and give you a lift, or if you're feeling down at a certain day, but along with the Bible, you know, I'm still a work in progress. It reminds me of my golf game. That's still a work in progress also. But I'll probably never perfect it, but my Christian walk, I got the, you know, book right here, the rule book. Rule book of holy living. Like I said, I want to keep being an example, I guess, because I still have family members that alcohol that affects their lives, affects their living, affects their family. And I need to continue to be a light for them, a good example, and let them know that I'm available. I don't want to scare them off. I don't want to come on too strong, but I want them to know the path I'm on now is all God's doing and God's leading. Like I said, there are just so many. I know, they go back to the stories that I try to forget, but they're still there because I just don't have another reason to believe that God was the only one that got me through it. He was right there, and I'll never ever be able to thank Him enough. And like I said, I don't know. I said I shared a song here that really, probably one of my favorites, that this is what I sang when I was first up here. Then I'll close with this, and it really says the whole story. The song was, "Because He Lives, I Can Face Tomorrow." Thank you.
That's my big brother.
Amen.
He does love his family very, very much, and so continue to pray for the salvation of the Froman family, because that's all Bernie wants. He'd give up his golf game for that. Thank you, Bernie. Felt like I was in the cooler. Our next hymn of praise is 312, Calvary Covers It All, 312.
Together and to be exposed to these tremendous songs. I trust that we'll let the words, the lyrics really sink down deeply into our heart. I'm glad that Calvary does cover everything. It's complete atonement. That's what that word atonement means, covering. Our sin is covered and it's gone. And Jesus washed it away in his own blood on the cross. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, as we turn to you and turn to your word, open our eyes and give us increased understanding of what it really says, what it really means, how it applies to each of us. Thank you for a beautiful day to gather. Thank you, Lord, for our country. Thank you for the liberties we have, the freedom of worship, to come together and to praise the name of Jesus. We thank you for that name above all names. Thank you for Bernie, and thank you for his courage and willingness to bear his heart and to share his word and testimony. We appreciate this dear brother. Thank you for the Smith family. And again, we, Lord, pray for their safety. We pray for good health. We pray that they would look forward to the many blessings and opportunities that will await them out west. And we thank you that they can be with us this day. Bless the reception to follow. And may they be blessed. May they be encouraged. And Lord, we pray that you will lead the way and go before them as you faithfully will and do. And we praise you, Lord, for coming to your table today so that we might be reminded once more, and how many times we need a lot of reminding, of how much you do love us and how much you gave so that we might live. And now direct our understanding of the word, and thank you so much, Father, for this precious gathering today. For Jesus' sake, amen. I'd like to have us turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. 1 Corinthians 1 today. We'll begin with verse 17 and continue through verse 25. Very appropriate for communion to discuss together the message of the cross. The message of the cross. Paul was concerned for the believers in Corinth, and as we see from verses 10 through 11, 12, 13, 14, he really begins to talk about them being together in the name of Jesus, but there were divisions in the church, and the church needed a special touch, and the need of unity in the fellowship can't be overstressed in ministry. We're not all carbon copies. Unity is not uniformity, okay? We are all different. We all have different backgrounds, but we need to emphasize that which we agree to and we know that really makes us one body in Christ, okay? What really makes us one is our faith in Christ. And coming to the foot of the cross and realizing all he did there, one way or another, we came to put our faith and trust in Christ as Savior. And that is what really joins us together, as by one Holy Spirit, we've all been baptized into one body, the Bible says. And now, though we're many members, yet we're one local body in Christ here at Yates Baptist. And so let's rejoice in that fact. We're all different, and yet I'm so glad a day is coming when there won't be any more divisions and splinter groups and various opinions, and we won't be opinionated when we get to heaven. We will be so obsessed and enthralled with Jesus Christ, nothing will really matter else other than that. And so let's look at verse 17, because Paul reminds us here in this verse, Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel. Not with wisdom of words, lest the cross of Christ should be made of no effect. For the message of the cross is to them is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world through wisdom did not know God, it pleased God through the foolishness of the message preached to save those who believe. For Jews request a sign and Greeks seek after wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified. To the Jews, a stumbling block, to the Greeks, foolishness, but to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God, because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. What an amazing statement from the Apostle Paul here. The message of the cross. I want you to notice on your guide sheet, I left a verse with you from Proverbs chapter 1 and verse 7 where Solomon wrote, "There the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. But fools despise wisdom and instruction." In other words, fools despise wisdom from God. They despise the Bible. They despise anything it has to stand for. They set it aside and live their own lives and act as the captain of their own fate. Okay? The Bible is amazingly clear in the contrast between those who are truly wise and those that are very foolish. And we need to take this really to heart. I can't think of any better statement on the realm of wisdom than the book of Proverbs found in our Old Testament. It's just loaded with the depth of God's wisdom. And I would encourage you to dig in. There's nothing like wise living and making wise choices and steering clear of the way of the world. The Bible tells us not to love the world, neither the things in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father isn't in him. Now, that's not saying we shouldn't love people, but it does say that we shouldn't fall in love with the way of the world's thinking, its system, its means of operation, because it leaves God completely out of the picture. And in reality, the world and its people worship, whether they realize it or not, and most of them do not, they worship the god of this age. And we know that's Satan. And so the world is really being filled with increasing Satan worship. And that's even in the realm of religious circles, folks. This isn't just something found in the tabloids or what's sitting on someone's mantle, okay? There's much in the realm of religion today that is not the truth. And it runs contrary to Scripture, and we need to be aware of this simply because evil men and seducers, the Bible says, will become worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. Therefore, we need to continue in the Word of God and study the Word of truth, so that we'll be able to discern truth from error. But in a nutshell, Jesus is the way. He is the truth. He is the life. If he isn't, he lied. There are not many ways to the top of the mountain. There are not many ways to get into heaven. There's only one narrow way. The world may say we're narrow and bigoted, and, well, we're being biblical. That's the way it is. I don't believe Jesus ever lied. How could the truth lie? You see, he spoke the word of truth. I want you to notice these points on your guide sheet. You can follow along with me here. We see the apostles' primary ministry was to preach the gospel. Okay? I don't believe he really spent a lot of time pastoring churches. That wasn't his primary calling. He was an apostle. He was a missionary. He was a church planter. But his primary ministry wasn't even to baptize new believers. His primary ministry was to preach the gospel. And the gospel's communicated clearly, not by the wisdom of words, notice that, not by the wisdom of words, but by the wisdom of the word. See the difference? There's a lot of talk out there. There's, Lord knows how many words are being spoken. So it isn't merely built upon the foundation of mere philosophy and people's way of thinking and opinions. It's instead built upon the word of wisdom, which we know of as the Bible. Okay? The gospel, what is it? It's the good news of Jesus Christ. And it's three-dimensional, the good news. He died for our sins, right? According to the scriptures. And what's the second point? He was buried, and he rose again the third day, according to Lyle Drake. Oh, that, I'm sorry. It's according to the scriptures. Okay? According to the scriptures. Now, the point is, that's good news, but have we come to that point where we believe the gospel, we've received Christ, and we're thanking him daily? Brother Bernie, thank you. I always love to hear believers say, I can't thank God enough. That's what heaven is for. We'll have all eternity to thank and praise him. So take heart, okay? It's going to get a lot better someday. But in the meantime, we know things aren't getting a whole lot better on planet Earth until Jesus comes for us. Colossians chapter 2, verse 8, Paul warned the early believers there, beware lest anyone cheat you through philosophy and empty deceit, according to the tradition of men, according to the basic principles of the world, and not according to Christ. Colossians is a good letter because it emphasizes Christ as head of all things in absolute authority, and that he is to receive preeminence over all persons, over all things, okay? So it emphasizes the headship of Christ as head of the body. And so you can check that out sometime. But Paul knew what his primary ministry was. He was really focused. And I might add that it's our business to preach the gospel, folks. Mark 16:15, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature, every living person, irregardless of culture, language, education. Everywhere we're to go with the gospel, to the uttermost part of the earth, Acts 1:8. Okay? Preaching the gospel. If we are to make disciples, we need to preach the gospel. That's really the real thrust here. No one can become a follower of Christ unless they hear the gospel. And no one can hear the gospel unless someone preaches it. And number two, how can they preach unless they're sent? Notice what Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 17. Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel. He realized he was sent by the Lord to do what he was doing. Notice, secondly, the primary message of the gospel is literally here, the word of the cross. I've entitled this the message of the cross, but that word, the original word that Paul uses, is logos. In the beginning was the word. The word was with God. The word was God. And so when I think of this, I think of not only the message of the gospel, but if we look at it even a step further, it refers, I believe, to Christ himself. Jesus Christ himself was the very word of the cross. To those who are perishing, it's just foolishness. Foolishness. Alan Redpath, in his book, The Royal Route to Heaven, stated these words, just as being saved is a constant process, so is perishing. It is becoming more and more interested in worldly things, accepting defeat and compromise without blushing. How many who have professed to be Christians for a long time find it so much easier now to submit to things that are selfish, mean, and worldly? How desperately he goes on to say, we all need power to stand for the right, power to speak for the Lord Jesus, power to live for him day by day. The word of the cross, to those who are perishing, is foolishness, but for those of us who are being saved, it's the power of God. The power of God. The cross of Christ. Romans 1:16, what did Paul say? I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek or to the Gentile, okay? So Paul's primary ministry is to preach the gospel. Primary message of the gospel is the word of the cross. It's at the heart and center of the good news of Christ. And thirdly, the word of the cross primarily speaks of Christ crucified. This isn't just a cross. There were many that were crucified in those days by the Romans, but it's the cross of Christ itself. To the Jews, it became a stumbling block. They could not begin to believe that their coming Messiah would be rejected and suffer and hang on the accursed tree. But he did. Jesus was their true Messiah. They rejected him, and the way he came was a stumbling block in their way of thinking. So they rejected him. They sought to slay him. And yet it was all within the sovereign plan of God that he die upon the cross for our sins, as we know. To the Greeks, to the world out there, to Gentile, the Gentile world, the thought of the cross, the thought that Jesus is the only way, is just absolutely ridiculous and a real serious question mark. I find that this really becomes the line drawn in the sand in many ways. Even in religious circles today, and much of what is happening with our churches, many of our churches are beginning to believe that as time goes along, more and more trails lead to the top of the mountain. We need to be aware of this. And this is the message that really causes lots of irritation, bitter disagreement, and even the world's hate. Is to think that Jesus is the only way, and he is. There is a way that seems right to a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. There is a way that seems right. That word seems is critical there. And with many people out there, they're going down a path that seems right, seems okay. I had a teenage boy tell me years ago, I'm so happy the way I am. Why do I need Jesus? A very good in school, gifted athlete. But I began to share with him what would happen if you were in a sudden accident and no longer could play ball. Well, what then? Well, he realized his happiness was dependent upon things going quite well. Nice family, not a poor home, low income, but well, pretty well-to-do, well-known, popular in school. Perhaps he may have received a sports scholarship to the college of his choice. And everything looked good, flowing along smoothly, very talented. But what would happen if all of a sudden there was a reversal? What then? Is our happiness dependent on things going just so, the way we want it to go? And after a while, what was really wonderful is he began to think twice. What's really amazing, he says, could you share some more Bible verses with me? He loved basketball. I had a key to the local gym. Man, it was a lot of fun, man. When you have a key to the gym, you're all set. Okay, we shot hoops and then would gather underneath the hoops for a time in the Word. I don't know what happened with him. I don't know if he's even alive today. But it was an opportunity to care, to sow some seed, and watch God work and he was working, I'm glad to say. Paul Van Gorder said the gospel's not a system of philosophy, but God's means of salvation. Wherever Christians gather, let them take heed that the wisdom of the world does not infiltrate the assembly and divide God's people. The church at Corinth, located in a city and a nation in which human wisdom had ripened and come to full fruit, was tempted to upgrade, in quotes, upgrade its position by adopting man's philosophy. The apostle reminded them that it was the proclamation of Christ crucified and risen that had brought the power and wisdom of God to them. Carnality, notice this now, carnality, which is living according to the flesh, our own desires, carnality will be evidenced in any group of believers that exalts human wisdom in message or method. Well stated by Paul Van Gorder. The natural man. Who's the natural man? It's the man of the world who thinks that the things of God are foolishness. He cannot know them because they're spiritually discerned. I like what Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 2. I determined not to know anything among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. Now that's focus. He never strayed from the gospel message. You know one thing I really appreciate about the late Billy Graham? He never strayed from the gospel message. Never did in all his years of ministry, from a tent ministry in Los Angeles in 1949 all the way through to his last breath. He never strayed from the gospel. He never ran down another person's ministry. He kept his focus, and he really left a tremendous influence on his own wife, on his family. Look at Franklin Graham today. Look at Will Graham. They're out there proclaiming the gospel all over the world. Samaritan's Purse that touches so many people in sudden emergencies that the news, the social media never discusses or talks about. But they're always the first ones there on the spot. I just really praise God that in this day and age of watering down the truth and in this day and age of just endless compromise, there are men and women who stand firm in the Word of God and on the gospel message and never stray from that. The men who will be serving the communion elements, if you could please come to the front, and we will distribute the elements of the communion table. We are indeed not only reminded of what Jesus did for us on the cross, but this is one way God has given to help unify his people. We keep our mind on the central message of the Word of God, and that's the very cross of Christ. And I'm so thankful that our Savior, praise God, is risen, alive and well, and he's coming again, and we will observe the Lord's table until the trumpet sounds. That's pretty neat. We know when it's time to go home. Isn't that a nice thought? Going home. We've got a mic, yeah, and that's not just a person. The broken bread symbolizes the broken body of Jesus Christ, right? His body was broken. No bone was broken in fulfillment of prophecy, but his body was beaten and broken terribly, and no artist could ever reveal fully what a horrific scene that must have been. Mary was told in the temple that a sword would pierce through her own soul. Who was there? Who was there with him in his dying moments?
his own mom. What a scene.
I pray that with the Lord's table, with other means and methods, perhaps these scenes that are written in Scripture, that God would form a real mental and heart picture of what it may have been like. It's good for us, good exercise. All he went through for you, for me. All because he loved us. I'm so glad that'll never end. He'll always love us, and I seek to love him more and more. Merle, good to have you home from all your travels. Even though you went to a Pirates game, we love you anyhow. If you could offer the blessing, brother.
Father, we come to you this morning and we just thank you and praise you for this opportunity to remember. Help us to be still here this morning, Lord, and just think on these things and to remember the price you paid for us that allows us to stand faultless before the throne. Without you, we have no hope. We're grateful for Jesus this morning. We're thankful and grateful for your blood that will never lose its power. It reaches to the highest mountain. It flows to the lowest valley. Your blood that gives me strength from day to day will never, ever lose its power. We're so thankful and grateful for the price that you paid. Help us to be ever mindful of that. Help us to never take it for granted. We love you this morning, dear God, because you first loved us. Thank you, for it's in Christ's name we prayed. Amen.
The Bible says Jesus, when he had given thanks, he broke the bread and he said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." Isn't it wonderful that Jesus is the wonder bread from heaven? The cup. Brad, if you could offer the blessing on the cup this morning and praise him for the shed blood.
Oh, Father, we just thank you for this plan that you've given to us. And as Wally mentioned here in his spoken word and in his song, it is that blood that leads us to salvation, that covers us, covers over our sins when we truly repent, Lord God. Oh, we cannot thank you enough for that. Father, it started thousands of years ago with the Passover and that shedding of blood of the Lamb. They had to eat the flesh and drink, and they didn't have to drink the blood, but they had the blood represented salvation. Oh, Father, and I thank you for that plan again in Jesus' name and for what he did. Amen.
Jesus said, this cup is the new covenant, the new testament in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. The cup of blessing. We'd like to close our service with hymn number 487. As this is good news, there's room at the cross. For you, for me. Let's stand as we sing.
Grace.
word come. We must come to Christ. There's someone here that has never come to Christ, that they would reach out to him and find he's been ready all along to receive them and to take them home. So thank you, Lord, for what you're going to do as a result of the service. Thank you for what we have witnessed and what we've received. Now may we go in peace to love and serve our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, till he comes. Amen.